I'm here at useR 2014 at UCLA, and I'm talking to David Smith. Hi, David.
Hi, good to meet you.
Pleasure. So here we are at useR. Can you tell me a little bit about, you know, why you come to useR and what it is that you hope to get out of these conferences?
Well, this is my favorite conference to come to every year because, I mean, the R community is just so amazing. People have been using R for, you know, maybe 5 years, 6 years, maybe 10 years. And also people that have just learned R want to come together and learn from each other and how to do statistics, how to do data visualization, and how to have fun with data. It's really cool.
It really is. That's, you know, one of the things that drew me to this entire field. So you are famous for a bunch of things, but in particular, your blog. Your blog really for a very long time, I didn't know if I'd still say has, you know, has been or is the center of the R community. Can you tell me a little bit about your experiences blogging in this community and really being this nexus?
Yeah, well, when I got started, R was really well known in the academic sector. People had been using R for a long, long time to do research in statistics. But it wasn't very well known in the commercial sector. And I work for a company, Revolution Analytics, whose mission is to bring R into companies. But the challenge that we had was we'd go and visit a company and you'd talk about R and they'd say, what's R? So what I wanted to do was to start up a blog to kind of tell the world about all the really cool things that people were doing with R. And like I said, when I got started, I was the only one, and nobody was really writing about R. So I'd look at, you know, journal articles and media articles, and I'd see like maybe a chart that looked like somebody had done it in R, because the charts are pretty recognizable. Sure. And I'd reach out to the author and say, hey, did you do this in R? And like 9 times out of 10, they'd say, yes, I did. And they'd be happy for me to sort of communicate that. So I'd write these little stories about what people were doing with R and how that was cool. And it really just took off from there. That was really how R became known sort of outside of the academic community.
So you kind of sit in a privileged position then that you've really seen the evolution of R as it's left sort of academia and is now pretty deeply entrenched in the commercial world. Can you talk to me a little bit about that evolution and how you see R being used in industry today?
Yeah, it's really just a matter of two things. You know, one is the fact that R is really cool and people that use it can do a lot with it. But it's also the fact that it's over the last, you know, 4 or 5 years that companies in general have really become interested in data. You know, for a long time it was just the pharmaceutical industry or the financial industry that employed a lot of statisticians that were doing really deep data analysis. But once big data became a thing, you know, companies were hiring statisticians and data scientists to come in and, you know, make sense of all the data they collected. And these statisticians and data scientists knew R. So that's really what made R, you know, something that was really attractive to companies, because that's how they made use of their data.
So you used the term big data, probably the buzziest term that I can think of. I like asking this question, how do you define big data?
Big data is just big data with big problems.
Okay.
You know, companies have worked with large data sets for a long, long time, but it was in a very regimented, you know, standard type of a way. You did experiments or you collected financial data, and that was pretty easy to manage. But I think what changed with the whole big data world was companies started saving data that they previously just threw away. You know, just every single transaction or every web click.
So the marginal cost of storage.
Marginal cost of storage went way, way down. Hadoop in particular became an environment that was very cheap to set up and very easy to set up. That meant companies could start collecting all of this data. And the reason they did this is because some companies like Google in particular demonstrated that if you collect a lot of data, you can do really cool things with it, like turning over the entire advertising industry. Yeah. And then other companies saw this and say, hey, we collect lots of data, why don't we save it and see what we can do with it and hire data scientists to figure out that problem.
So yeah, so you think that it's sort of the birth of this entire data scientist role and sort of big data coming together that has pushed it from academia into commercial.
Exactly. And you know, data science is sexy. And I think that's an important thing because, you know, for a long time, you know, I had trained as a statistician and I still call myself a statistician. But a lot of the times when you talk to people and you'd say, you know, at a party, hey, I'm a statistician, you know, they'd slowly back away. Exactly. Because statisticians were kind of viewed as, you know, somebody that sits in a dark office, you know, just working on reports, or even worse, you know, somebody that collects baseball statistics. So I really liked it when this term data scientist came about, because it gave this impression, a very real impression, of somebody that doesn't just crunch numbers, but also help solve problems and communicate information and tell stories. Mm-hmm. I think that's a much more rounded description of what statisticians really do.
Sure.
It's just marketing.
And there's a joke, what's the difference between a statistician and a data scientist? You know, it's, a data scientist lives on the West Coast.
All right, yeah.
So the R community itself is really interesting. And
yeah.
As somebody who's relatively new to it, there seems to be generations, there seems to be pockets, there's large groups of biostatisticians, mm-hmm. there's groups of quantitative analysts.
Yep.
Again, I think you have a privileged view of the R community. Mm-hmm. Can you talk to me a little bit about what you see in the R community, and even better, if you can be a little forward-looking about what kinds of challenges is the R community going to face, and mm-hmm. you know, what kind of things can we preemptively start addressing?
Yeah, I mean, I think you make a really good point there, is that the R community is really diverse. You know, R is a language for programming with data, but data is in just about every industry.
Yeah.
So people are using R in the financial sector, and in the pharmaceutical sector, and for manufacturing, and for marketing. But I think what's really cool about R is that it's not just a programming language. You know, it's a language for communicating ideas.
It really is.
And, you know, once upon a time when you did statistics, you know, you'd publish a paper in a journal and probably nobody would ever see it. But these days, you don't just publish that paper, you also publish code in the R language as a package to this amazing network called CRAN that the creators of R created as a way of sharing code and information with other people. And I think that's one of the things that's made R really successful. And I think one of the things that R has been unique at, and something that's really reflected well in this conference, is that ideas from one industry can cross-pollinate over into other industries in a way that, you know, hasn't really been easy to do before. You know, I've worked with some people at a marketing company in San Francisco, and they help companies, you know, deal with advertising and figure out where their advertising dollars are spent. But the data scientist there, now, she brought in models from her previous experience in biostatistics to apply to marketing, and it works really, really well. But again, this is just a great example of, because that code was available in R, you know, she could take this into this other domain and make it really successful.
So, you gave a great presentation yesterday, basically about reproducibility.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to talk about that presentation a little?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I got really interested in the concept of reproducibility a few years ago when I went to the Bioconductor conference in Seattle back in 2011. And I just saw this really amazing presentation about what happens when reproducibility fails. And it was about a cancer study that was published, which basically recommended, you know, there's a certain gene marker, and if you have this gene marker, you should take these drugs and it will help alleviate cancer. And it turned out it didn't work.
No.
And there were lawsuits, and there's a big story behind that. But these researchers wanted to have a look at that paper and figure out, well, what went wrong? And it turned out they couldn't figure it out because the data wasn't available, and the code wasn't available, and the spreadsheets weren't available. And, you know, they did this big forensic analysis of the printed paper, which was all they had, and measured data points off the charts to try and figure out what the underlying data was. And then they realized that there was this big mistake, which ultimately caused people to be given the wrong drugs and died. It was a terrible story. But if only the underlying research, the data and the code had been available, you know, that kind of thing might have been averted. So that's what got me interested in reproducibility from that point of view. It's also really important on the business side. You know, I work with a lot of companies that use R in, you know, mission-critical production applications. You know, there's R code running in real time in the back office that's driving their marketing or their sales or whatever. And if that code breaks, then their business is down.
Yeah.
So reliability and reproducibility is really important to businesses as well. And, you know, I just wanted to look at ways of how we can help R programmers, especially when they're using R in conjunction with those thousands and thousands of packages that R developers have published, to make sure that when they write their code, it's reliable, and when they give their code to somebody else, it's reproducible.
No, makes sense. You know, I actually wonder if at some point in the future there won't be sort of a top-down edict from the National Science Foundation or someone like that actually demanding a level of reproducibility in public studies.
Yeah, well, really, science is definitely going in that direction, you know, to avoid the kinds of situations that I was talking about earlier on.
Yeah, they're damaging and cascading.
Yeah.
So switching real quick to the R language itself, So you've clearly been involved in R for a long time. Is there a feature of R that you're like, this is the feature that I love? Is there any little wart in R or feature in R that really just you like?
Yeah. I mean, I'll give one answer, which is obvious, you know, given sort of my relationship with the community, but that is the community. You know, that is something that's really unique about R that's different from any other software out there. It's not just the code, it's not just the language, it's not just the idioms, it's actually the people using it. And it's the fact that, you know, if you have trouble, you know, using R, you can search online and find communities that have shared, you know, ways to solve the problem. You know, often if you're trying to do a specific application of R, you can find somebody's already written a package that does exactly what you do. And R is just really unique like that. But if I was going to sort of answer the question the way you meant it, in terms of the language itself, you know, I think the coolest feature of R is functions.
Okay.
And that might seem really trite, but, you know, I actually remember, you know, back when I first encountered the S language, which was the predecessor language to R. And, you know, I was working at a science organization in Australia, analyzing some manufacturing data. And up until then, this whole idea that you could change the way software works was just, especially in statistical software, was just unknown. Mm-hmm. And then I suddenly found in this language that, hey, I can redefine the way things work. I'm doing this thing over and over again, and I can write a function that will enable me to replicate, you know, my own work really easily. And this whole idea of writing functions just really changed the way that I think about programming with data, and it's carried on, you know, to this day.
Cool. So if somebody's watching this video online and they're just now starting their journey in R, is there one thing that you would give them as advice? Is there one bit of advice?
I think it would be blogging, and that might sound strange.
No, it's fantastic.
Yeah. You know, I these days, I actually don't do a lot of R programming myself, but I write the blog, and what that lets me do is get into lots of, you know, little pieces of R, investigate packages and functions and applications and try that. And I'm certainly not deep in any of them, but certainly something that I find is just by writing about what these things do, I learn, you know, so much quicker about what they do, and it really helps me understand in a way that just reading documentation doesn't. So if I was going to give advice to an R programmer, it would be write about what you do. Keep a journal, keep a blog, you know, write notes, because I think it's just the best way to learn. And I refer back to my blog, you know, post 6 or 7 years ago. I just did it yesterday. It's just my own record of my learning. So I like that.
Fantastic. Yeah. So David, can you talk a little bit about how you think about building a community?
It's not really so much building as it is connecting. I mean, there are so many people using R, more than 2 million users around the world today, all doing really, really interesting things. But, you know, I kind of see my role as highlighting the interesting things that people do and communicating that to other members of the community and making connections that way. And I think also communicating what that community does to the rest of the world so that we can sort of expose the benefits of R to more R users. I think one of the things I'm, you know, kind of most proud of in that sense is, you know, really tracking the way that R has been growing over time and the user base is growing and how companies are adopting that. You know, to the point now where, you know, not only is R the fastest growing language by lots of statistics, it's also one of the highest paid skills. And I kind of feel proud that for all these people that have spent, you know, many years of their life learning the R language and contributing to the R language, that now they have great job opportunities ahead of them. Really interesting jobs, really well-paying jobs, because they have those skills in R.
Cool. That is a pretty fantastic thing to be proud of. Yeah. Well, David, thank you very much for your time.
Thanks. It's really been a real pleasure.
Cheers.